Trying to be the fire for you. Trying to be the sun, oh yeah. Trying to be your home and the place that you come to. Babe, I took the whole world and put it in your hands. Really trying hard, but I don't understand. Tell me, oh, how to be the one that you
was excruciating.
I was wondering what it was like for you to watch that.
Like, ooh. No, it's fine. It's good.
Oh, your vocal range gives me all the feels.
Really?
Holy crap.
Thanks, man. You know, that song has been an exercise in I mean, you know, what writing that song and like where I am and have been, you know, as far as like it, like the trajectory of my career and like what's going on live with me and how things have like kind of gotten bigger and like adjusting to that and the kind of songs that I feel are required to write, you know, like for to fill up spaces, because it's very different to like, you know, to perform. Like, it's been like, you know, I think I had my I just get all my different like sizes down, you know, and this last part has been one of the hardest, because I feel like I have to like kind of go like project so hard. In fact, I've had to like kind of readjust my vocal thing. But like, that song is not really, you know, for me anyway, I mean, it can be acoustic, but it's not fun. It's like trying to, you know, it's like trying to stuff 10 pounds of shit in a 5-pound bag, as they say, you know what I mean? I just like, it's too much, you know what I mean? I have to like reel it in, like, you know, it's trying to like shout like not that loudly, you know, but yeah, still sound like you're shouting.
Right.
Which I'm fucking shouting all the time. I apologize. But yeah, it is a whole thing.
Yeah. So how do you nail that one? Like when you go back out on tour night after night, you just bring it down a little bit?
No. I don't. I mean, I do best when I can go full. It's harder to like contain it, you know, sometimes like to sing a little softer sometimes, like with a song that requires, because it's like a, it's the way that you execute the notes is completely different when you're like have to sing it softer, and it's a whole adjustment. It took me like weeks to like kind of deal with playing that acoustic and not feeling, I mean, I kind of let it loose on that one. I'm just like tired of like, you know, keeping it so, you know, unapologetically, I just unapologetically like belted that one. I just was, you know, I look like I'm in a sassy mood in that that day. I think I was. I think I almost like broke my guitar like 1500 times, but I don't really like, I'm sick of these like home things. I mean, you know, listen, I mean, I'm happy that they're required, you know, that people even want them, but it still is just like, you know, like if I never have to play in my house again after this, I'll be like, great, fantastic.
Right. Yeah, for all of you listening right now, LP and I were talking about after this pandemic is over, we're going to have a couch burning party. Yeah. So whoever wants to join us.
This couch is done. It's over for you, couch. I don't want to see you ever again. We're done. We're not dating anymore.
You got to save the puppy pillow because that's your dog, right?
Oh, that's my dog. Yeah, this is kind of new. This a fan made it for me and gave it to me an American fan and gave it to me at the drive-in show, and it literally really does look like my dog. Hold on a second, let's see if I can find him.
Orson,
there he is in real life.
Dang, that is spot on. Like looking, what a cool gift.
It's like looking in a mirror or something. Yeah. But yeah, it's pretty incredible.
Awesome. Let's just kind of start with some easy stuff. Like what are your musical influences? And then I want to know non-musical influences.
Okay. Kristen Hunter here is really cracking me up. Like that one spot, I keep thinking it's live and I just keep looking at, hi, if you're looking. Hi. She's the only face I see. Okay, my non-musical influences and musical influences?
Yeah.
All right. Let's see. I mean, it's kind of, they're one and the same in a way, you know. I guess. I mean, I kind of like musical, I'm like, I have like the kind of the four pillars, which I think are kind of like Roy Orbison, Beatles, Stones, and probably like Queen. Alternating with Led Zeppelin. Did I say Led Zeppelin already? Roy Orbison, Stones, Beatles, Queen, Led Zeppelin. Yeah, like stuff like that. I mean, you know, and then there's like the female side, which is like Aretha Franklin, Joni Mitchell, Chaka Khan, Stevie Nicks kind of thing. Like, I'm a classics person, you know? And then there's the Jeff Buckley, you know, Kurt Cobain thing. And even like Green Day a bit, like, that was like one of the where I learned how to like kind of press on the tone and like that I do a lot. Non-musical, what do we say? Influences or heroes? I mean, you know, like Picasso, like, you know, like just the prolificness of that. Leonard Cohen, even though he's like, you know, a musical one again. Bowie. That's also because I just feel like I like people that just carry on with their body of work, you know, to the end, to the bitter end. And that's like my plan. You know, I feel like that's the only thing worth striving for, really, is the ultimate, like, you know, body of work that you leave behind. I mean, I think I was very impressed with like Leonard Cohen and David Bowie, that both those records that they left right before they died were like up to par with their early stuff. And I was like, you know, because you're always kind of told, oh, everybody has a prime, and if you don't, you know, they do this. And I don't believe in that bullshit. I think that's, you know, that's another thing said by some dickhead record executive that wants to just like, you know, fuck 20-year-old girls. Hey, listen, be my guest. Go ahead. You know, but like, don't like make blanket statements that people can't like create shit that's dope, you know, whenever. Yeah. So anyway,
yeah.
Sorry for all the potty mouth, but that's how I roll, you know, and I'm in my own home. So no one's going to stop me. No one's stopping me.
This is our conversation. Yeah. It's not on the air. We can do whatever we want.
Kristen Hunter, don't you look at me like that with that same face.
Were you a shy kid, LP?
I'm both. I'm kind of like, you know, I'm shy as far as like, I don't like to put myself on the spot. Like, I like to like kind of, you know, I'm like kind of Mick Jagger in a Keith Richards suit. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm just like kind of like, yeah, whatever. I don't know. I just made that up. We're going to use that again. That's a keeper. I like it. That's good.
So did you start writing when you were younger? Did that kind of, how did that start for you for writing?
You know, no, I didn't. I didn't do any of that shit. I mean, I carried around a notebook and wrote things down, but I didn't feel like it was poetry. It always felt like of a musical nature, but I didn't really know how to like write songs. I thought like, you know, like writing songs to me was like, you know, before the age of like six, like where did babies come from kind of thing. Like, I have no idea. I didn't know what the hell you did to like get a song. And I still kind of don't, to be honest. I mean, I think it's still like a very kind of fall out of the midair, you know, kind of thing. A God factor, if you will. But yeah, I mean, I was raised to completely not believe that it was possible to be an entertainer in any way. Because my father said it's not possible to be an entertainer in any way, basically verbatim. So I kind of believed him, you know. It's just like a bad idea, you know. Be a doctor, be a lawyer. I was like, yeah, because you're so fucking happy and you're a lawyer. Like, I mean, that's like, yeah, like I'm gonna model my life after your alcoholic ass. Sure, sounds like a great idea, you know.
Yeah.
So. So I just kind of like did what I wanted to do, basically. And I had no idea how to do it, hence the wait. So, you know, just shots in the dark until like, oh shit, I hit something finally. But yeah. I mean, I think, you know, I think I just kind of, something was guiding me somehow. I think I just kept getting things that were like, you know, I've had like a substantial amount of record deals and all this, like, you know, I've had like 7 record deals in the States alone, like 4 majors, 3 indies. But things just always kept happening. Then I thought I was going to just be a writer for other people for a long time, which was ironic because one of the roadblocks of my artist career was that they didn't have the song for me. And then it was like, and then so I became a successful songwriter for other people. I was like, wow, that's very, very interesting and ironic and cool, you know. And I really didn't think, you know, by that time I'd already had 2 major labels and 2 indie deals, so I, you know, I definitely didn't think like, oh, you know, artist career is, you know, waiting in the wings, you know. I had no idea. So I just like kind of embarked on a writing career, kind of feeling like I, like, you know, got lucky, got in the back door kind of thing. And then I don't know, like, just I kept writing for myself. In fact, like, I was talking about this to in another interview today, that the ukulele, which I started playing just for fun as a like a cute kind of conversation piece and like aid to like writing lyrics. I would just like bring it to like big sessions. Like, I think the first session I ever brought it to was like this Rihanna session that I wound up getting the cut for. But I was like writing to track, to like, you know, big tracks done by like big producers. The Runners did that track. And but the ukulele was like instrumental in kind of stirring up my heart again, as far as like enjoying music, because, you know, when you make a passion your job, it's very easy to you know, start to get like, oh, it like to, it becomes work, like anything, you know. It's like I was saying, like when you're a kid and you love sports, and then like, and then suddenly you have to like kind of like do sports to keep in shape later, you're like, fucking hate sports. Sports suck. You know, like, how did I ever like sports? Sports suck.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, but then it's almost like that with music, you know, like you're like locked in a room, you know. I mean, I've had so many. When you're a writer, nobody gives a shit about whether you're inspired, whether you feel good, whether, you know, whether you're like in the mood.
Right,
you know,
right.
It's like you go. I remember I used to do these crazy sessions. I just go to Tokyo, and you know, you fly in, you've got to sleep that day. You wake up 11 o'clock. There's a dude at your door with his shoes off, all ready to go. You work from 11 to 6, like, and you're like, constant, you know. And then you know, and then the next day, and you the next day, and that's it, you know. And it's you don't go like, oh man, you know, I don't really feel like writing today. I think I'll go to the movies. You know, it's
right.
It's a real gun to your head kind of job.
Yeah. Well, I have a question. Okay. So that seems like it could be really lonely. I have a question. So like when you were in studio with Rihanna or whoever, where you're brought into the studio to write with the artist, that's kind of like a real intimate, vulnerable place that you, I feel like you have to get to with those artists to be able to get the best out of them.
Well, she wasn't there. They're not often there. You know, no, this is like, it's like, these are like writing camps, you know, that you go to and like, there's, you know, there's people in every room, like trying to get these, like, you know, I mean, there's like thousands of songs being offered. That's why it's like kind of, that's why songwriting is like, it's great, but it's also, I mean, so much competition. You got to write even more songs to like kind of, you know, see if you can like ever get that, you know. But I have written with artists, you know, like it is a vulnerable place, and it's a weird place. Like I have a interesting story. Like I wrote for Leona Lewis to pitch a song to her, and then I wrote with Leona Lewis. And usually when I write with the artist, I usually very often, most of the time, kind of get the cut, it seems. So I like doing that, because the other way, you don't know. Like in this situation, like I think she had just gone through a breakup, and I wrote this really fucking sad song for her, like, you know. And then when I wrote with her, I didn't tell her I wrote a song for her, because she writes. So it's like, I feel like, you know, I wouldn't mention that, but you know, A&R guys are always like behind your back trying to get people to write songs for you. Mm-hmm. That, you know, they're like, you should do this song, even though you didn't write it.
Yeah.
But I was talking to her, and I was like, she was like, she mentioned a breakup, and I said, oh yeah, it was a really bad, you know, pretty good. And she's like, no, we're actually friends. It was mutual. It was cool. I was like, okay.
Okay, great.
Great. I was like, I felt your pain, Leona, over the miles. You know, like, yeah, it was so, it's kind of like, I don't know. I that's why I just try to, I write universally now. I don't try to like, kind of like get in their shoes per se, you know, and truth be told, most of the time, like even like Celine Dion just one of my songs on her new record, and she I think she just liked my voice, my stuff, like my songs and how I sang it, and she took one of my songs that I was like possibly going to use for this record, but I wasn't actually going to use it. I wish I wrote with her, because I think I would have been able to write a better song than that one, to be honest. And I know why she picked it, because it had this like modulation in it where when like, you know, like the thing, I was like, aha, I knew it. I knew you were going to pick that.
Awesome. Yeah. I was curious, like what your icebreaker would be when you get in, when you actually get in a room with an artist, but I feel like the ukulele would be a great icebreaker, right?
The ukulele. I mean, you know, like a bottle of gin, you know,
a bottle of gin. The
yeah.
I love it. All right. Yeah. I've got a question from Anne, who wanted to know how you landed the theme song for South of Nowhere.
Oh man, I don't know. Like that was like that's a fluke, you know. I mean, I think they were just like, hey, you know, this is a big gay show. Let's think of a big gay artist to sing it. You know, why not? You know, yeah. I was really happy to be a part of that show. I thought it was a cool show. Mm-hmm.
So people always ask you about your identity, and I guess, you know, a lot of people are trying to figure out their identity and live their true selves. Do you think social media is helping people do that, or do you think it's hindering people from doing that?
You know, I don't know. I think the jury's pretty much still out on that one. I think people are always like kind of trying to, you know, show their best side on social media, you know, or at least make it seem like, you know, I don't know if has anyone gone through a breakup yet with social media, and you know, like you check in on people like, she's stoked, she's fine, she didn't care, and then you know the real story is that they're like, you know, like just showing all the best shit, you know.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, I think it's interesting to examine, obviously, in a way. I think it ultimately, in a way, it doesn't matter, because it's still just like kind of the like kind of a churning of ideas and showing people, you know, even if it's like somewhat fake, what's possible, you know. What it doesn't show, you know, are the growing pains of the situation. That's the only thing. That's why people want, you know, instant gratification, and they don't understand that it takes, you know, there's many stages to you know, becoming, to ultimately weaving your your ideal identity that, yeah, you know, that serves you, you know, and feels good.
Yeah. Do you ever talk about your tattoos and where they're from?
Usually in bed with someone special. No, I don't have any.
There's a cool one on your arm you could see when you're playing guitar.
The Panther. This is my newest one, I think. Yeah, this is the, I got this in Russia from this tattoo artist that also did this rooster on my foot, which I also like to call my cock. But it's nice, you know, like she was a very good tattoo artist. And in Russia, you know, it's like, it's just fun to say you got a tattoo in Russia. Mm-hmm. But I got my ship tattoo was an interesting one because I was kind of in a really weird place. Like it became such a, like, I, you know, a part actually of my identity in the last few years. But it started so, like, I didn't even know I was ever going to, like, you know, really have a career again. You know, I played, you know, all these songs that were actually going to blow my shit up, you know. I played them all for Warner Brothers. There was a new regime, all the, like, you know, the higher ups, and they asked me to come in to play my new shit for them. I knew they weren't going to push my record that I had kind of, like, made for 2 years, which took too long. But then they asked me to play them my new shit. I played them my new shit, and they were like, "That's great, bye." They dropped me. So I was like free falling in 2015. And I just broken up with my girlfriend at the time. And I just was like, you know, trying to like desperately, like, kind of figure out the strands of my life, where it was all going, you know. And I'd always wanted to get a ship. I have a lot of sailor tattoos. That's kind of like, I kind of enjoy the sailor metaphor or motif, if you will, you know, like to, that's what I feel like in life in general. But I was on my way to Russia to do a private gig. Irony of ironies, the Russian owners of Warner Brothers, I was like one of two of their favorite bands, and I played one of their birthday parties, and then I got a Russian billionaire, like, offered me a private gig in Russia, which turned into like six more, and it was something that kept me afloat during this time when I was dropped. But so I was on my way to Russia for one of these private shows, and I was I hadn't gotten any Russian tattoos yet because I hadn't had a hit there. Like these preempted my actual having like number ones and shit like that there. So I was, I was like on my way, and I was like looking at Russian prison tattoos for some reason. And I saw this dude with a big ship on his chest. I was like, holy shit, you know, I'm just going to put that ship on my chest when I get back to New York. So I went back to New York and I got it. I got that tattooed, and it was just such a, like, I don't know. It was me getting comfortable with the journey, you know, like in this backbreaking stage of like trying to get to where I was getting. If someone fucking said to me, "It's about the journey," I was like, "Don't say that word. I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear about the journey. Don't say it." But then I was like, I'm cool with the journey. It is the journey. And then, you know, like the little cartoon animals come out and, you know, whatever, yeah, crawl up on your shoulders and sing and shit, you know. I was like, I get it. Oh my god. And so now I have this ship on my chest, and it's, you know, and I love it.
And it looks really good when you wear button down shirts.
Hey, yep, it does. And so, you know, and then, which brings me back to laying in bed talking about my tattoos. So it's full circle, and we're back.
How about this has been really great, LP, thank you for the time. Are you just like, I want to keep talking to you, but I want to respect your time and everyone else's too. So we're going to get to the last.
I have nothing to do, but I have everything to do. I don't want to bore people.
Awesome. So hit me up. Are you like a big romantic at heart? I kind of feel like with your songwriting.
Yeah, it's a pain in the ass, to be honest with you. But it's good for songwriting, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, I am. I do. I try to go above and beyond. I think that's really, I mean, that's what we have. I mean, I think like your romantic relationships can be, I mean, you know, it's not everybody's like thing to have, you know, to really focus on those kind of relationships. But for me, in my experience, I feel like that's the biggest kind of mirror, you know, like you really learn a lot about yourself through your lovers, I think, you know.
Yeah.
They see everything, you know, they see the kind of the full arc of you.
Yeah. So. If you're smart, you do. If you pay attention and you listen and learn and grow, you do, right?
I mean, I guess it feels like I'm always like kind of, you know, getting the drink thrown in my face at the end of it. So I don't think I'm probably not learning anything, you know. It's like, you dick.
As long as it's gin.
But it's always for different reasons. There you go. Yeah. See, like it always shits the bed for a different reason, which is great. I think I'm versatile.
You know? Awesome. All right. One more question from a listener, and then we'll play your last two performances. Let's see. There's so many good ones here. Denise said, your songs and hooks always get stuck in her head. Does that ever happen to you? And what song's been stuck in your head recently?
Oh, of my own? Yeah, it's kind of annoying and embarrassing. I mean, it's nice when, you know, I think the one that you love keeps that first line that, not a tune, not a tune. I don't know, that just keeps popping out all the time. But you know, I mean, there could be different ones. I mean, oddly, you know, Lost on You still gets stuck in my head, you know. But yeah, I do get things stuck in my head a lot. I think it's not any, you know, it doesn't mean because the song is so great. It's just because I have to constantly do these live streams.
Right.
It's just like in my head all the time.
What about someone else's jam that's stuck in your head right now?
Oh God. Well, I mean, what's the one that I'm singing? I feel like it's like an old song and I'm always whistling it. It's not Funky Town. Is it that one? What's the one that I always it's so annoying. Like, I mean, it's like probably, I think, you know, like I've been like singing it for like 10 years straight. I'll get back to you on that one. But
all
yeah,
right.
I do get one stuck in my head. I always sing the what's that Beatles song? Oh man, that's weird. The ones that are always stuck in your head now mm-hmm. I can't think.
It's like when you used to go into a record store and you knew there were 10 albums you wanted to buy, and then you get there and you're like, I don't know.
Oh yeah. It's like when someone asks me who my influences are and I don't usually remember. I'm just like, I don't know.
Last time I saw you, leaning coke in a closet at the shack of my mom's. We were happy and on it. There were too many people. There was fun, there was evil, and we both took the ride. But it was colder than fuck for a night in LA. I couldn't stop thinking if I was okay. You were making me laugh, shit was making me sway. And I thought I could fly. How long can you go? 'Cause I wanna know, how low can you go? How low can you go? 'Cause I wanna know, how low can you go? Happy and sad, but I didn't know why. I'm still thinking now while I'm touching the sky. It's been a long, long time, and so much happens in between. The days catch fire like gasoline. Just tell me what's the worst you've seen. I wanna know. Go, 'cause I wanna.
What's up?
Well,
thanks for listening,
guys.
Dang, I do it all the time. Hello, can you go? Is on rotation right now on 88.9 and Lost on You. So is that like a old-timey Western? Like, it sounds like that chuck wagon whistle that you're doing. You know what I mean? Like rounding him up. Is that just me?
I mean, that's just which one? That one?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's like a, you know, a dog whistle from, like, you know, we had dogs when I was a kid. I would always call them like that. And my dad is able to do it with his hand in his mouth. I can't do it like that. But I learned how to do it. On my way to my grandfather's house one day in the back of the car.
Nice.
I was like, oh, wow. And yeah, I never did it in a song. That was the first time. I just was like, me and Mike were messing around. He's like, give me a couple of different whistles. Cause he's heard me do stuff. And then, when we put that one in there, it just was like, you know, it's interesting.
Yeah. All right. So my final question, LP, what did your childhood smell like?
Oh God. Probably like cedar, like wood.
Why's that?
I don't know. I just feel like we always had a wood burning stove, or like a fireplace. And my dad really liked, you know, the outdoors kind of thing. And I know he always really smelled like he was a smoker. And I don't know. I actually love that. Like, I mean, I don't smoke and I don't like it as a, you know, as a thing for health, obviously, but he always smelled really good. I don't know why. He just like never smelled like, I don't know. He smelled like wood and smoke, I guess, like cigarette smoke mostly.
Nice. Oh, that's lovely. Yeah. I love it. All right.
And he's, you know, I mean, he's dead now. So,
yeah. So is it good?
That's not funny. I'm sorry. I don't mean to laugh at death. I'm just saying that, you know, I mean, you know, not surprisingly, he's not with us any longer. So, but he smelled good while he was here. I'll tell you what.
That's amazing. Thanks for sharing that memory with us.
Sure. Sorry, everyone.
All right. So, we've got a couple songs of yours in rotation. Yeah. Is there a full-on album coming out or?
There is. Oh my God. Yeah. There's an album on the horizon. And we just, you know, we're kind of like tempering when to put it out according to like when, you know, touring gets back. But yeah, that's one of the nice things that happened this year is like, I didn't have to make this record from the road as much. And there was a lot, I feel like, song wise, I really got to, there's a lot of last minute additions, you know, to like from sessions I did, this past year and I really, you know, dialed in some shit pretty hard. So, I'm looking forward to it, you know, you know, putting it out.
All right. We can't wait to hear.
Thank you so much, you guys.
Music.
Thanks for dealing with my tangents and my potty mouth and all the things.
Thanks for your kindness and generosity to do these. It means a lot to our listeners to feel a little connected when we can't be. This year has been such a fun show. So
I'm like a hugger. So it's like, I really miss like hugging people and stuff, you know, it's like, with girl. Hey, thanks. Shan. Is it Shan? Is that how you say it?
Shan. Yeah.
Thanks, Shan.
Right. Hi, you should be able to.
Patrick, you're adorable. I keep looking at you, Patrick, with your suspenders on like that. What's up, kid?
Thank you.
Hello, my dad wore suspenders. Yes.
Okay.
Anyway, thank you so much.
Thank you, LP.
It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
And thanks for playing the song, you guys. I really appreciate you. And it's been really, really nice talking.
Yeah.
I get to do it in person someday.
Yeah. I hope I get to hug you.
I want to sing. Yeah, man. I want to sing these songs not in my house. How's that?
Yeah.
Yay. Got to have goals, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we'll let everyone on this call know when the couch burning parties start.
Please, yeah. We'll Zoom couch burn. That would be so sick. That'd be pretty amazing. You think that'd be pretty legendary for us to have a Zoom couch burn, you know?
Yeah,
and I'll buy everybody couches afterwards. Depending on how the song goes. If you know, if we have a big hit with this song, I'll buy everybody in a Zoom call a fucking couch. You know what I'm saying? Anybody ever tell you that? Nobody's ever told you that.
And we're recording it, so, you know.
Yeah. It's on record. That's it.
But that means everybody here's got to buy the record to help it be a hit. Right? Yes. Now you're invested. Right.
Only if you buy the ring. You got to show your receipt. I'm not getting that couch made without the receipt.
Awesome. All right, LP. And thanks, everybody, for joining us tonight. This is awesome.
Thank you.
Take care. Be well.